in the educational field. It is my obligation to introduce Professor Dr. Preeti Mishra Ma'am. Dr. Preeti Mishra Ma'am, he belongs to the Department of Human Rights, School of Legal Studies, Baba Bhimrao Ambedkar University, Lucknow. She has done her postgraduate degree in economics and law from Lucknow University. She has awarded LLD in law from Lucknow University in 2004. She has been coordinator of Department of Law, School of Legal Studies of that same university. Professor Mishra has also served as a full-time lecturer in law department of Sri JNPG College, as well as Sia Postgraduate College, Lucknow. He has served different institutions of national and international repute. Her research interest lies in the field of women and gender issues, ethnic minority, marginalized section of the society, human rights of rural and urban poor, family violence, and many more other areas. Professor Mishra has received Certificate of Excellence for her outstanding academic distinction. She has awarded for academic work by JNPG College in 2005. Sankalp Seva Sanman by Sankalp Parivar of Lucknow in 2008. He has conferred Certificate of Honor for writing work by All Press and Writers Association Lucknow in 2012. She has got the honor of attending first position in different activities publishing research work, the journal with a high impact factor in 2013 and 14. So she has published many books like Domestic Violence Against Women, Legal Control and Judicial Response, published by Deep and Deep Publication. That is textbook on Indian Penal Code, law relating to protection of women, cases and materials. She has written course material for postgraduate diploma in criminal justice course run by School of Law, IGNU. So she has the honor to edit Ratanlal Bidwala's books of law crimes, a commentary on Indian Penal Code in 2013. And also made certain editing work in marriage law and family courts law, that is 2015 and 18. Professor Mishra is a member of various administrative academic bodies of Baba Saheb Ambedkar University and other universities also. So Professor Mishra presented more than 100 papers in the national and international seminars and conferences. He has guided 9 PhD and also at the moment some PhD scholars are doing research under her guidance. She served as a visiting faculty in different reputed universities of India as well as world also. She has attended so many international seminars and visited China, Bangladesh and other areas of importance. So she has also delivered more than 75 invited talks and lectures on social and human rights issues. On this occasion, we find such versatile personality who will deal with this topic. And dear friends, as we are at this moment both offline and online configuration, so please maintain discipline and listen to the great personality, Professor Dr. Preeti Mishra Ma'am. Now over to please.
A very, very good morning to all of you. I wish you all a very, very happy International Women's Day. Thank you, Dr. Das. Thank you so much for inviting me here. And also thank you for such a nice introduction. Let me begin my lecture. The topic that has been given is Violence Against Women, a Roadblock in Women Empowerment. We all know that this year's International Women's Day theme given by United Nations Women is Women in Leadership, Achieving an Equal Future in COVID-19 World. When I looked upon the theme given by the International Women's Day by the United Nations Women, suddenly when Dr. Das talked to me regarding this lecture, one thing came to my mind. that why the women in leadership are so few, why women are still not finding their place in the political process of the country. Even whenever I think of myself joining some political party or going into the that arena, I find it very, very difficult. So I think that what is the reason why women are not there in the leadership position, and why there is a kind of vacuum? If you look at the highest offices, whether it is an educational institution or whether it is any other avocation or the profession, we find that is some kind of fear in the mind of women always keeps them away from having a role to play at the highest level. So one of the very, very grave thing which is there is the violence, because the violence only the women are not able to take part in the developmental process of the country, as well as they are not able to achieve the height which they want to. Even if they want to utilize their capabilities, their aptitude, their all the potential to the fullest extent, but still they find it difficult to make their mark in the society. Though we cannot say that women are not achieving heights or not making mark in the society, they are doing. But a very little percentage of that is there. A larger section of women is still facing a lot of violence in the society, because of which she is denied education as well as the employment opportunities. So the topic that came into mind was that whether this violence against women is a roadblock in the women empowerment. So let us analyze that how far this statement is correct, whether the violence against women is posing a threat in the way of women empowerment. So if we look around myself, I too find that there are various personal experiences with different kinds of women who have told their miseries, and they have shared their experiences with me. And because of that, they are not able to excel in the field where they are, because they are always pushed back into their family, in the society, by their family members, by their colleagues. So because of the violence that is there, whether it is in the private space or it is in the public space, this is the violence which makes them not to utilize their potential to the fullest extent. And if you look at the scenario of crime in our society, we find that day by day this crime is increasing. And if you look at some of the recent incidents, whether it is in UP or anywhere in the country, in any state of the country, we find that violence or the offenses against women are not stopping. Even after having the criminal law amendments, even in 2013, the overhaul was done in the administration of criminal justice. A lot of new offenses were created under the IPC. A lot of procedural changes were brought. Administrative authorities were also held responsible if they are not going to register the FIR or doing the investigation properly. But we still find that the crime rate is increasing in the society, to the extent that it is from a female fetishize to the burning alive of a woman. So if you look at the NCRB data, and the latest data that is available is of 2019. And we find that there has been 7.3% increase in 2019 as compared to 2018. And the offenses which are there in the name of violence against women, it is not only the cruelty by the husband or his relative, but it is the outraging the modesty of a woman. It is the kidnapping and abduction of the woman, as well as there are various offenses which are defined under specific laws of the country. So this crime is not stopping. And what is the saddest part is that in this period of corona crisis, when the things were in lockdown and people were not there in personal contact, then the online harassment has also started. So even the cyber crime against women has registered an increase of 63.5% over 2018. So not it is the physical world, but also the cyber world where the offenses are being committed against the women. So why the women are so vulnerable? The main question arises. And when you look upon so many violence against the women, a natural question is in the mind that why the women are so vulnerable to violence. And before we understand what is the meaning of violence against women. We need to understand itself. What is the meaning of vulnerability? Why a woman is thought vulnerable to different kind of offenses or to crimes? So vulnerability is one kind of circumstance or the characteristics which make a group of people prone to damaging effect of a hazard or the danger. And this hazard or danger may come from any quarter. It may be, it may happen in the privacy or it may happen in the public spaces. So vulnerability is the inability to resist a hazard or the danger where one fails to respond when a disaster or danger has occurred. So why women are so vulnerable? I have asked this question to my fellow beings, to my colleagues, to my students also when I am there in my class teaching women in law paper. And always the answer that I get is that women are physically inferior. So that may be one reason that women are naturally interested with some kind of physical characteristics because of which they become vulnerable. Then there are various social circumstances, various economic conditions, various environmental conditions, and sometimes the culture is also responsible for the cause of violence or the offense against the women. So as you all know, whenever the natural disaster occurs, whether there is an earthquake or there is a like the present disaster that we witness in the Uttarakhand, we find that women are the most sufferers because either they are losing their breadwinners in these kinds of environmental hazards or because of the social conditions which are there, which a woman has to face because of the poverty, because of the poor situation, or because she is unemployed, she is not working, she is not getting job. So all these things make a woman very, very vulnerable to different kinds of violence, and because of which she is not able to face the danger or the hazard to which she is put into. And sometimes this vulnerability is compounded and becomes very, very complex when a woman is suffering from some kind of morbidities. Like we hear of morbidity in COVID cases, and that if there is a COVID and one is suffering from high blood pressure or diabetes, then it becomes much more grave. And similarly, the women too have some kind of morbidity, and that may be, and they may be unmarried, they may be single women, they may belong to depressed class of the society, that is to the scheduled caste or the scheduled tribe, or if a woman is pregnant or she is lunatic, or if she is suffering from some kind of physical disability. That thing also increases the vulnerability of a woman to face the violence. Because we all know that violence is a universal phenomena. It is not limited to any place. It is not limited to time. It happens everywhere, irrespective of the country, howsoever developed it may be. So this violence becomes much more grave when it is combined with such kinds of morbidities, like if a woman is suffering from PWD's condition, or she is a single woman, or she is a single woman. So that enhances the chance of the offenses against the women. So if we look at the scenario that what kind of offenses are being committed against the women, which are really a roadblock in the progress or the development of the women, we find that millions of women are facing a severe kind of harassment in their daily life. And sometimes this harassment or the violence is labeled as a wear and tear of the domestic life. And because of this wear and tear of the daily life, women are subjected to various kinds of domestic hazards and the dangers or the violence. The women, we all know that dowry is still a fact in our society. Though we are living in the 21st century, the education level has also increased in the society, but still we find that even today, the women are being violated, they are being killed, they are being burnt alive because of the dowry. So these are the domestic violence which are happening daily somewhere in the life of a woman, which put a kind of hindrance in her developmental process. And sometimes I read a sentence that violence against women is from cradle to grave. But what I see is that it is not from cradle to grave, but it is from womb to grave. As soon as the fetus comes in the womb of the mother, one starts deliberating whether it is going to be a girl child or whether it is going to be a male child. And the harassment starts if there is a patriarchal mindset in the family that we should get rid of this female fetus as soon as it is possible. So, starting from the female feticide to the causing of death, such kinds of violence are against women happening daily in our life. So, if we look at the extent of the violence or the kind of violence that is being committed against the women, there are various forms. It may be female feticide, it may be infanticide, and child marriage is still a fact of our society. Sometimes people do raise question whether there are child marriages in this century also. But even this corona crisis, COVID-19 period also, it was reported that more than 30% marriages have occurred as child marriage. Because of the crisis which families were facing, because of the poor economic conditions, it forced them to indulge into the child marriages. So, child marriage is also one of the facets of the violence against a girl child or a woman. Because when a child is married at an early stage, then she loses a lot of opportunities of the life. Whether it is her right to work or right to education, that is denied to her. And then this child marriage also have a very, very grave and adverse effect upon the health of the woman. So, besides having the female feticide, infanticide, we have the problem of child marriages. And when a girl enters into her puberty, whatever little freedom she was enjoying as a girl child is taken away from her. Because of the adolescence comes lots of challenges in her personal life as well as in the professional life. And there she is subjected to sexual assault, sexual violence, molestation, eve teasing. Sometimes many girls have to leave their education in the lurch, in the middle, because of the violence. Because they are not able to reach to the educational institutions from their home. Because the distance that they have to cover between the house to the school or the universities or the colleges, during that distance they face a lot of sexual assault, eve teasing and molestation, because of which the parents force that they should drop their education. So, because of this education, what I want to say is that this right to education is very much affected because of the violence or the offense that is there against the women. And then if a woman is married, then as soon as she enters into the matrimonial home, there also, if the things are not good, if the family members in the matrimonial home are greedy in nature, they force the women to bring the dowry again and again. And even they, to the extent they force their parents, their siblings to bring the kind of property or dowry to the family. So, in the name of dowry also, and then there is cruelty by the husband or the male relatives also. So, even in the matrimonial home, the women are not free from violence. Because we all know that in Indian society, the marriage institution is very much glamorized, and a girl has a lot of dreams when she gets into the marriage, that she will have such kind of a house, there she will have such kind of a husband or the family members. But when she is there, she faces the reality, and she comes to realize the fact that that dream has shattered. So in matrimonial life is also not happy for many of the women still. And if a woman is married, it's okay. She is facing matrimonial offenses. But if she is a single woman, she is not married, or she is a divorcee, or she is a widower, there also she has to face lots of violence. So we see that at every stage of life, a woman has to face one kind of marriage or the other. Then another fact that has come to light is that of the marital rape also. Though this thing is not still realized or as a thing upon which the law should be made, but it is a fact of the matrimonial homes that some kind of perverse sexual behavior are there so far as the married women are concerned. So the marital rape is also the reality. And when a woman enters into her adulthood, or in the she becomes an elder woman, when she becomes dependent upon the other family members, there also she has to run after each and everyone for the sustenance of her life, because there is no one to attend her needs. Even if she is ill, nobody is there to take her to the hospital. So she has to beg to each and every one of the family to help her to go to the hospital or to give some kind of economic assistance. So whether it is the life of a girl child, whether it is the life of an adolescent woman, whether it is the life of the married woman, whether it is the life of the unmarried woman or that of an elderly woman, every stage of her life, the woman has to face one kind of violence or the other, because of which she is not able to concentrate on what she wants to do in her life. Because at one time or the other, she is running from pillar to post, dealing with the authorities that how to get rid of these unwanted, unnatural things in her life. So if we look upon the effect of the violence that is happening every day in the life of the women, we think that what effect it do have on the mentality of the woman, on the psychology of a woman. Because whenever the violence is there, it may not be physical violence. It may be mental violence. It may be psychological violence. It may be emotional violence. And sometimes the violence is occurring in the cyber world. And sometimes this happens that she cannot share these things with the other fellow members or the colleagues because of the shame or because of the ridicule to which she may be put into. So she is not able to share her harassment even to her family members or to her dear friends or to colleagues. And so it causes a lot of effects on not only on the physical health of the women, but also on the psychology and the psyche of the women. So this violence, what does it do? It creates a kind of sense of dependency in the mind of the women. And because of this sense of dependency, she finds that there is no other alternative but to continue to live and to depend upon the abusive partner or the family members for due to lack of any other choice to which she is left to. So this sense of dependency is very, very grave thing which has occurred just because of the violence, because she loses her self-confidence. There is no positive regard for herself. Whatever capability she has, she feels that it is no longer of any use, because whenever she is subjected to violence, she always feels that she is not capable of doing anything in her life. So a kind of psychological fear is there in the mind of the women, and because of this physical violence which is there, a lot of women have lost their life and limb also because of this violence. And one of the study was done in the Bombay, which said that if you go to the orthopedic department, there are lots of people come with a broken bones. So whenever a woman is coming with a broken bone or a broken finger, the questions are put to her: why your finger is broken? Why your hands are broken? So she is not able to answer, because she knows that this all has happened because of the domestic violence which was there back in her home. So a lot of domestic violence is causing the loss of physical life and that of the limb to the women also. And sometimes this physical effect is such that her health is also affected negatively. And she may have the acidic conditions, she may lose the pregnancy. So the violence which is occurring not only affects her mental or the physical condition, but also subjects her to a lot of emotional stress. And because of that emotional stress, if she is pregnant, she loses her pregnancy, or she has so many kind of stomach related diseases. We all know about IBM, that irritable bowel syndrome. That is because of the tension that a person is having in her or his life. So this violence is a very, very grave thing, because of which a woman always lives in constant fear that sometimes from somewhere some danger will come, some hazard will come, and she will not be able to live the life normally. And because of this violence, she also sometimes locks herself in a room. So she is subjected to isolation. She loses her contact with the family members and the friends because of the stress. So because of this mental fear, because of the dependency, and because of the threats which she is facing daily in her life, she loses the familial relations also. And if there are children, and suppose a woman is married and she is having children also, then not only that woman is subjected to violence, but their children are also subjected to violence in order to force a woman to come to the terms with the husband or the family members of the husband. So because of all this violence, a woman loses a positive regard for herself, because of which she loses a lot of opportunities in her life to go for the education, to go for the work. And this creates a roadblock, a bottleneck in the progress and development of the women. Even though we are living in the 21st century, we are celebrating International Women's Day, but it is a fact of life that more than 90% women are still facing violence in their homes, in the streets, and even where they are working at the workplace also, the women are subjected to a lot of violence. So we need to understand that what are the causes of violence, why women are subjected to. Though we earlier discussed that it is because of the physiology of a woman, the physiology that has been assigned to her by the nature, because of which she is subjected to violence. Because no one can be violated as a woman can be violated. The crime like rape occurs more against the women than against men. Though the sexual assault cases may be there against the male also. But so far as women are concerned, there are rape, there are gang rape. Gang rapes have also increased these times after the 2013 amendment of criminal law, when this penalty has been increased for the rape cases. And so far as the group crimes are concerned or the gang rapes are concerned, the minimum punishment is 20 years and maximum can be the death penalty. But still, these offenses are not stopping. They are increasing day by day. So we need to analyze the cause, that what is happening and why it is happening. So always it is said that women are being subjected to violence because of the religion, because what is there written in the religious text, that is very much responsible for the violence against women. Because we find in various religious scriptures that a lot many things have been said negatively about the women. Though there are some scriptures which are positive in nature, but there are some which are very, very negative in the sense. Because whenever a woman is married and she is going for the blessings, she is always she always gets the blessing of having a male child and not the girl child. Nobody says that you should get a girl child. Everybody says that you should be blessed with a male child. So that kind of patriarchal soch is the patriarchal mentality is there because of this religious scriptures writing which are there. It does not matter whether it is Hindu religion, Muslim religion, or the Christianity. Even in the foreign societies also, the life of a girl child or a woman is faced with violence everywhere. So it is a religion which is very, very responsible somewhere, which has been the cause of violence against women. Then if a woman belongs to a lower strata of society, if she belongs to a scheduled caste or scheduled tribe, then the violence becomes manifold, because in the name of caste, she is being subjected to violence. Then there are various social sanctions, because our socialization process is such where the male and female are taught to behave in a different way. They are taught to dress up in a different way. They are taught to show their emotions in a different way. So because of this socialization, the socialization process in bringing up of the child, in which a girl child or a male child is brought, that is very, very different. Because we say that women cannot laugh loud. She cannot go out in the odd hours. She cannot wear certain kind of dresses. So what the social strictures are, what the social sanctions are, these are some kind of hindrances which are put on the freedom and liberty of the women. So various kind of social sanctions are there. You all understand, I think, and there is no need to explain. And because of these social sanctions also, women are faced to a lot of violence. And then the simple thing, everybody says that it is a patriarchal attitude. And this patriarchy is not only in the mind of the male, it is in our system, because of which the women also become of patriarchal mindset. Because it is a woman who wants to have a male child first. If she is pregnant, she thinks that the first child should be a male child. So that will increase her status in the family. So that kind of patriarchal mentality is there in the mind of the women also. And that is because of the systemic growth in which a woman is put into. So because of this patriarchy, because of the socialization process, because of the religious writings, because of belonging to different caste or strata of the society, woman is subjected to a loss of violence. Then we need to understand the modern concept or the modern causes of violence against women. So because of the materialistic tendencies that are there in our society, where everybody is running after the money, everybody has become self-centered. Nobody is able to stop and think about the will and woes of the others. So our society has become very, very self-centric, very, very egoistic in nature. We are not bothered about the sentiments or the emotions of the other. We have become a kind of insensitive society because of this modernization and the globalization, where we are more concerned with our own personal growth. And that has also been somewhere responsible for the violence against women. Because we all know that there are sibling rivalry as well as rivalry between the husband and wife also. So if male and female both are working, if the husband and wife both are working, there also there are egoistic problems. That if a woman is earning more than men, then it becomes a cause of violence in the family sometimes. And if a woman is working, and if a man is not employed, he is unemployed, or he has lost his job because of some reason, there also the woman is subjected to violence and she is thought of the cause of that unemployment also. So that kind of psyche is there in the modern society also, because of which, due to increase of the competitiveness in the society, because of the increase of the materialistic tendencies in the society, because of the loss of affinity between the familial relation, a lot of violence is there. And we all know that our family structure has also changed. When we had the joint family system, then there was someone there to look after the other. So even if the violence happened or some kind of disagreements are there, elder person used to be there to reconcile the things, to mend the ways of their family members. But because of the change of the family structure from joint family system to nuclear family system, now there is no one to reconciliate the thing or to bring a kind of harmonization in the family. So because of this change in familial structure also, we are facing the violence or the tussle or the clashes, ego clashes in our family, and these small things lead to bigger things in life. So if the fire is to be burnt, a kind of a matchstick should be there. So this thing is working like that. So if the family members are not there to support the other family members because of the change in the family structure, because of the nuclear family structure, we find that the things become worse within the family relations. And sometimes there may be some pathological reasons and some psychological reasons also. So if a person is suffering from some kind of psychological disease or having some kind of pathological problem, if facing some kind of disability, a physical disability or the mental disability, that may also become a cause of perpetrator of violence. So these pathological reasons and psychological reasons are also responsible for causing violence against women. Then some men are there of the pedophilic nature. They enjoy indulging into some kind of pervert behavior, because of which find that even the married women are being subjected to sexual violence by their own husbands. So things are not happening in the natural way of life, but some kind of pervert sexual behavior is there. So these are the reasons which explain the causes of violence against women. Now we need to understand that what has been the effort by the legislature at the national level as well as at the international level to deal with the violence or the offenses against the women. Today is the International Women Day. We would like to look upon the international efforts that have been done for securing the human rights of women and securing the other legal rights of women, so that the roadblocks which are there in the path of the development of the woman or the progress of the woman can be removed. And for that, at the international level, from the inception of the United Nations organization, a lot of effort have been made for ameliorating the condition of women. So, for the first time at the international level, the term violence was also defined. Because we all know that violence is not a legal term. It is a term which comes with socio-psychological dynamics. So, in law, there was no definition of violence before this Domestic Violence Act came in 2005. But before 2005, the CEDAW, the Convention on Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women, provided the definition of violence. And the Declaration on the Elimination of All Forms of Violence Against Women, which was adopted by the United Nations in 1993, it defined the violence as the act of gender-based violence. And what is the meaning of gender-based violence? That results in or which is likely to result in physical, sexual or psychological harm or suffering to women. So at the international level, the effort has been made to define the term violence. And this violence, the term violence, not only includes the actual violence, but also the threat of violence, the coercion, the arbitrary deprivation of liberty, and whether this deprivation of liberty is occurring in the public life or in the private life. And this definition of violence against women has been recognized by the Vienna Accord of 1994 as well as by the Beijing Declaration of 1995. So from the very inception, the United Nations have strived to protect the dignity of the women by giving them various human rights and various fundamental rights. Because Article 1 of the UDHR says that all the human beings are born free and equal in dignity and rights. And its Article 2 says that everyone is entitled to all the rights and freedoms which are there in the Declaration without any distinction of any kind, whether it is of race, color, sex, language, religion, political or other opinion. So it does not matter where a woman belongs to which country she belongs to which religion she belongs to which caste she belongs to, she will enjoy the same kind of rights and freedom which are there for the other gender of the society. Besides this Universal Declaration of Human Rights that was declared in 1948, there are other two covenants also, that International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights as well as International Covenant on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights that also forbids discrimination on the ground of sex. Then in 1951, the International Labour Organization also brought a convention for the equal remuneration for men and women workers to guarantee the equal fare to both men and women. So from the very inception at the international level, a lot of effort have been made not only to define the violence against women, but also to secure to her the legal and the human rights. Then a very important convention is that of 1962, that is a convention on consent to marriage, minimum age for marriage and registration of marriage, because it is one of the human rights of women that she is not put into marriage institution at an early stage of her life, because we all know because of the child marriages she loses the opportunity for the education and the employment. So this particular international standard provides and prohibits the child marriage. Then in 1986 came the Declaration on the Right to Development, which specifies that all the states will cooperate in the realization of the human rights and fundamental freedoms for all without any discrimination to religion, race, caste, sex or anything. And this convention, you all must remember that it is known as the Bill of Rights for Women. It is so important. It is just like the Magna Carta for the women. So this convention, which we known by the name of CEDAW, is very, very important in the sense that it is the Bill of Rights for Women, and it extends to 7 fields of activity in the life of a woman, which is political, economic, social, cultural, legal, familial and personal. So no aspect of life of a woman has been left unattended by these international conventions. So these international conventions are very, very important, which have worked as landmark in securing the human rights to women. And then we all know that from 1975 to 1985, the decade was marked as the International Women Decade. And for the first time in 1975, the International Year for Women was celebrated in the city of Mexico. And then subsequently 2 more conferences were done in 1980 in Copenhagen and then in Nairobi in 1985. So these 3 international conferences are very, very important. Then the 4th one that we all know in the name of Beijing Declaration of 1995. It is also very, very important so far as the securing the rights of women are concerned. And the term which we use today, that the women rights are human rights or the special human rights of a women. So this particular term was coined in this Beijing Declaration of 1995 only. So the first lady of US, the Hillary Clinton, when she gave her speech in the United Nations conference in the Beijing Declaration, she was the one who used the term that women rights are the human rights, or women should have their human rights. So in on September 5, 1995, when the Hillary Clinton took the podium in front of the various representatives of the world, and in her speech, she cited a number of instances of violence against women, including the rape, female genital mutilation, dowry burnings, domestic violence, and she termed that these violence are nothing else but the violation of the human rights of women. And it is the Hillary Clinton who labeled these human right violations as a violation of the rights of the women. And from there, this thing has started, and now these terms are used synonymously. The women have the human rights, or women should have some special human rights, because we are always put a question before us whether the women's rights are different from that of men's right, or the rights of the other gender of the society, whether women have some kind of special human rights. Yes, women do have some special human rights because of the physiology that has been assigned to her by the nature. So she has the reproductive rights. She has the right to abortion. She has the right to choose the sex of the child. So these are the special human rights which have been assigned to a woman. The right to have the surrogacy. These are the special rights of a woman. So all the rights are there for everybody, but there may be some special rights for the women. And the credit goes to Hillary Clinton for bringing out this thing that the women have some special human rights, and whenever the violation of human rights are occurring in relation to women, it is a violation of the human right of a woman. So now the human rights and women rights are the terms which are used synonymously in the mainstream. So now we will look up at our national provisions which are there for the protection of the rights of women in order to protect the women from the violence. At the international level, lots of efforts have been made, and in pursuance of that only, we have the national legislations also. So if which is the grand norm of our country, that is the constitution. If you look upon the constitution, the preamble of the constitution starts with the word "we the people of India". So "we" includes all the genders of the society, irrespective of its caste or the religion or the gender. So this constitution belongs to everyone. So whatever rights are there in the constitution, these are meant for everyone. So women are not left out from enjoying the constitutional rights. and the preamble itself talks about the justice. What kind of justice? Socio-economic and political. So these socio-economic and political justice are not there for the other segments of the society, but also for the women living within the boundaries of India. So if you look at the constitutional scheme, we find that women enjoy all the fundamental rights which are there in the part 3rd of the constitution, but they have something extra also. Because Article 15 Clause 3 says that special laws can be made for the protection of the women and children. And in pursuance of this Article 15 Clause 3, a lot many specific legislations have been passed protecting the rights of the women, so that a woman may develop to her full potentiality. So, whatever article you talk about, whether it is Article 14, 15, 16, or if you talk about the Article 21, it is a repository of many rights, and also a very, very important repository for the women rights also. Because so far as the right to dignity is concerned, it is not only enshrined in our fundamental duties that we have to renounce the practices derogatory to the dignity of women. But this right to dignity has also been ensured within the Article 21 of the Constitution through various judicial decisions. Even you all know there has been the cases that even a woman of easy virtue can have the right to privacy. She also has the right to dignity. She can deny her customer that she is not willing to lend herself to him. So that kind of right has been given to that extent. The right has been ensured to women within the Constitution of India. So we have this constitutional right where women are enjoying the right to life and personal liberty, the right to work, the right to avocation, the right to dignity, and right to enjoy the religion also. Because we all know though there are these constitutional rights are there, the fundamental duty is also there, a specific laws are also there. If we start counting the specific laws that are there for the protection of women, there are more than 30 special laws which are there protecting the rights of women. But still, in spite of having so many laws, having the constitutional protection, the women are not feeling safe. And if you look at the secular law, that is their IPC, Indian Penal Code, a lot of violence has been defined against women. There also women can go for the relief if the offense or the violence are taking place against her. So some new kind of offenses have also been read into the IPC. The acid attack has been brought as an offense under the Indian Penal Code. Then we have the offense of sexual harassment at workplace. Though the specific legislation is there of 2013, but IPC Section 354A also defines the sexual harassment, though the definition is the same. Then we have the offense of voyeurism. We have the offense of disrobing of a woman. And very, very important, the eve teasing, which was considered to be a very, very little offense, now it is offense as stalking. And stalking not only in the physical world, but also in the cyber world. It is an offense. So legislation is trying, the statutes is trying, our lawmakers are trying to protect the women, that they are not subjected to violence and they are able to take part in the development of the country. They may also contribute in the development of the country. But in spite of these many laws, there has been a study and that we are losing our GDP because of the violence. Women are not able to contribute. They are not able to report to the workplace because of the violence, because of which the country is losing its economy. And one of the study which has been done during the COVID period is that if the women were not subjected to violence and if they are free and fair and given the fair chance of opportunity to work, they can add trillions of dollars to the economy of the world. So in all the countries, the women are facing violence, and during this COVID period, the crisis became manifold, and even this United Nations has to give the term of pandemic. So there was the epidemic or the endemic of corona crisis, then there was pandemic of the violence that was occurring in the private lives of the women. So domestic life of women has become very, very difficult during this corona crisis, because woman has to face a lot of challenges. She has to balance between the domestic life as well as between the work life. And in during the balancing of life and the workplace, she is running from pillar to post to manage the things at the home as well as to manage the things at the office places. And during this she is subjected to violence, subjected to ridicule, that now the office is much more important for you than this domestic work. Why you are not looking after your children? So as if that it is the sole responsibility of the woman to look after the child. So still in some of the families, the male persons are not sharing the burden of raising the children, or they are not looking after in what way the children are being educated. It is still the primary responsibility of a woman to take care of the child, or to take care of the education of the child, or to see that how she or he is doing well in her life. So still this primary duty of a woman that is there in the domestic front has not been compromised. So in the name of balancing between house and the work, a woman is subjected to violence, and because of that also the country is losing a lot of its GDP. So country is losing its GDP not only because of the violence of child marriage, but also because of the violence that is there in the domestic front as well as in the workplace. Now we would like to analyze that what initiative recently have been taken by the Government of India to shun the cases of violence against women, so that the road may be made smooth for the progress and development of the woman, so that she is also able to raise herself in a dignified manner. She may go for the education, she may go for the work, and may come out with her full colors. So for that, Ministry of Home Affairs has issued advisory to all the states that now it is mandatory for the police to act whenever the crime against woman is happening. In the IPC also, you know, section 166A was added, that if the police personnel are not registering the FIR, etc., they may be put into action. They may be subjected to action. So this Ministry of Home Affairs has issued the advisory that police need to act immediately if a crime is reported against women. Then this advisory also says that in cases of sexual violence, the samples are to be collected with the forensic methods so that the vital evidences are not lost. And investigation of rape cases should be completed within 2 months. And Ministry of Home Affairs has also come out with the online crime reporting portal known as Investigation Tracking System for Sexual Offences. Because it is a fact of life that sexual violence against women has increased to a great extent. And to deal with it, the ministry has come with very iron hands. And now a kind of repository has been created where they are having the data of the sexual offenders, though it is being shared within the authorities only. But our UP government, Yogi Adityanath ji, he has also issued a Mission Shakti program where we are having various conferences and the seminars, and it has been strictly pointed out by the Chief Minister that if the male persons are not going to mend their ways and they continue to indulge in the violence against women, their names will be put up at the public places, so that they may not indulge in the act again. So a kind of shaming and naming will be there of the offenders if they do not shudder from committing these kinds of violence. So very laudable and praiseworthy efforts have been taken by the ministry. Our National Commission of Women has also done a lot. Even during this corona period, they had come out with a special WhatsApp number where the women could report their cases. And then they have started a digital training program also, through which they are giving training to women and girls in the educational institutions so that the women empowerment can be done. And this National Services Authority, they are also doing a lot. They are providing field legal services. During this corona crisis, they had started the one-stop center where the woman could go for the relief of the grievances which were there against her, so that she may get every kind of relief under the same roof. She can report the case there. She can get the investigation there and all the relief. So one stop center was proposed by the National Legal Authority during this corona crisis. Then Supreme Court and High Court have also done a lot during this COVID period, and always we all know that though the time is short, so I am not taking up the judicial decisions. We all know that the Supreme Court decisions are there, though in the recently some decisions have come which have been criticized a lot, especially that of the Bombay High Court case that was there against the sexual violence of a girl child, and that was by a woman judge only that has been criticized. So the problem of sensitization is there, because all the authorities which are there, they need to be sensitized. Whether it is the police authority, whether the judiciary, whether it is the administrative authorities, or whether the persons who are there working in the education institution, all needs some kind of sensitization on the issues of the women. So in this series, our NHRC, the National Human Rights Commission, is also not far behind. Though it responded late, only in October 2020, it came out for certain guidelines to prevent the gender-based violence. But on the website of NHRC, we can find that what guidelines the NHRC has issued for protecting the women against the gender-based violence. So judiciary has got a very, very important role so far as protection of women rights are concerned, and so far as the role of the woman in the development and the progress of the country is concerned. Because laws are the only the skeletons. It is the judiciary which provide the flesh and blood to it through its interpretation. So whatever law is there, it is to be interpreted by the judiciary in the positive way, so that justice can be done with the women, so that the dispensation of justice is done with the women. So what are the solutions? Now I will come to the solution. What will be the solution for removing the bottlenecks which are there in the progress and development of the women? So we all know that there can be no shortcut, because the crime against women is there from the time immemorial. Since I took birth, I have been listening to violence against women, and everybody who is there must be learning about the violence against women, that from time immemorial this thing is happening in our society. So sometimes it is cultural specific also. So there can be no shortcut to have any solution to stop the violence against women. But one thing is clear, that we need to do the rapid assessment of the gravity of violence. And then it is the responsibility basically of the state to have the kind of law and order situation where the fast tracking of cases is possible. Because we all know that justice delayed is justice denied. So if the justice is not done in a speedier way, it has no meaning at all, because the punishment loses its deterrent effect. We know what are the different objects of punishment. As a criminologist, we know what are the different objects of punishment. It may be preventive, it may be deterrent, it may be reformative. But deterrent effect is very, very important so far as the object of punishment is concerned. So if the judiciaries are not working in a fast way, the punishment loses its deterrent effect. So judiciary need to really fast track its cases. Though there are fast track courts are there, but they are not working in the fast track way. So the things need to be expedited. Then it is said that if you do not offend the violence will offend you. So if we are not raising our voices against the violence, if women are not raising our voices against the violence, then this violence is not going to leave us. So all the gender of the society, I would like to appeal to all the sections of the society that all need to be very, very sensitive. Whether it is male or the female, we don't need to have only the women organizations to work and protect the rights of the women. There can be male organizations also working for the protection of the women. Similarly, the women organization working for the safety of the men, because presently there has been lots of vices coming, that violence is not only against women but against men also. So being complementary to each other, because nature has created all the genders, whether male, female or anything. So all the genders have to coexist. We have to reconcile our interest. We have to harmonize our interest. We have to work in coordination with each other. We need to respect each other. So we have to work for the dignity and respect of the each other. And for this, a multi-sectoral approach is required. A kind of systemic change is required. we need to overhaul all the systems which are there, whether they are at the education institutions, whether the religious institutions, or whether there's a political institutions. So all kind of systematic or systemic changes are required. We need to sensitize each and every one who is there adorning a post or in a responsible position. Whether the politicians are there, they have to work in a responsible way. The teachers are there, they have to work in a responsible way. Or the authorities, the IAS officer, the administrative authorities who are there working for protecting the rights of the women, they all have to work in a very, very sensitive and in a coordinated way. Only then this gender equality or the equal share in the process and development of the country is possible. So what I believe is that it is the right of each and everyone to live in an atmosphere which is free of violence. Because if the atmosphere is not free of violence, we cannot utilize our capabilities, we cannot utilize our potential, we cannot do what we want to do, and we cannot have the right to life with dignity and the liberty which is guaranteed by our constitution if our lives are fraught with the violence. So first thing is first that we need to say no to violence, no to any kind of violence. So no tolerance is to be there so far violence is concerned. So we have to see that even in our neighborhood society, the violence is not happening. So it is our responsibility to see that each and everyone who is related to us or who is coming into contact with us or sharing his or her experiences with us, we have to be very, very sympathetic and empathetic towards them. We should not ridicule them. That though you are a working woman, still you are facing a kind of violence. You are sufficient enough to raise your voice at any forum. So women are sometimes made a kind of ridicule when they are facing violence. If they are in good position, they are working. And especially if the women are in the legal field. Because we all know that even the women who are working in the police field, they are not free from violence. They are facing violence also there. So this is a fact of life. So we need to sensitize each and every one of the society, and we need to say no to violence in a big way. Only then we can have a society which is violence free, and through it only we can ensure the growth and progress of a woman in a developmental process. So this campaign theme of this International Women Day of 2021 is choose to challenge. Choose to challenge. Hashtag choose to challenge. So what we need to challenge? I think we need to challenge our patriarchy, and then we need to challenge the biases that are existing in our society so that the equality may be ensured, so that awareness may be created, and the women may achieve the milestone that they want to achieve in the society. So with this hope, with this pray, I close my presentation. I know that I was suffering from some bad thought, so my voice was, I don't know how much clear it was, but I think that now it's over to Principal Sir.
Thank you, madam.
And thank you, sir, for giving me this opportunity, for sharing my thoughts with you all. And now if any questions are there, I will be happy to answer.
Thank you, madam. You have applauded us by your excellent deliberation. You have discussed different aspects of the topic. Various challenges faced by the women, international aspect, national aspect, constitutional aspect, regarding NHRC, judicial pronouncement, legal provision, and most importantly, sensitization of the issue. I am very much thankful to you, madam, despite your some challenges so far your health is concerned. You have taken total 1 hour for deliberation. I am sure my colleagues and my students, they might be getting much inspiration from your speech. Now it is, I am putting to the audience, if you have any question, you can make interaction with ma'am.